The knee joint is the largest and one of the most complex joints in the body. It carries our entire weight, and that is exactly why it's so prone to problems. Meniscus tears, ligament injuries, patellar dislocations, and of course, wear and tear like osteoarthritis show up in clinics all the time. But to understand why these things happen, we need to go inside the knee joint, look at how it's built from inside out. So in this video, we are going to break down the full anatomy of the knee joint. The menisci, its capsules, the ligaments, the patella, the bursae, and how it all comes together in movement. And as always, I will highlight some of the most common issues that can damage the knee joint. Because once you understand the structure, you will understand the injuries. What's up everyone, my name is Taim. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. If you've been watching my previous videos, you know that I have this thing to really understand something, I need to remove everything and add structures one by one. So what are the bones we can see now? It's the femur, the tibia, and the patella. These are the three bones that come together to form the knee joint. The bone down here is the fibula, and while the fibula is right next to the tibia here, notice how it just grabs onto the tibia and does not actually participate in the joint itself. It is not part of the articulation. So what are the actual articulating surfaces of the knee joint? Well, there are two main ones. The first is the femoral-tibial joint, which is between the distal end of the femur and the proximal end of the tibia. The second is the femoropatellar joint, which is between the femur and the back surface of the patella. So to visualize this, here we see the two curved condylar surfaces of the femur articulating with the relative flat articular surface of the tibia. And if we switch to a superior view, we can see those tibial surfaces more clearly. Make sense so far? Now, here in the middle, this anterior side of the femur is the area that is facing the patella. That is the femoropatellar joint. Just to see this more clearly, here is the femoral-tibial articulation, and here is the femoral-patellar articulation. These surfaces you're looking at now are what we call true direct articulating surfaces of the knee joints. You know, the knee joint takes a lot of weight and twisting and everything, and to support all this, our amazing body has extra layers of protection between these articulating surfaces. And the first I want to highlight, sitting in between these joints, are structures known as the menisci. They sit on top of the tibia and help deepen the articulating surface while also acting as shock absorbers. To understand them better, let's just remove the femur and look at them from this direction. We will see this. Now we can clearly see the shape and size of the medial and the lateral menisci. The medial one is more C-shaped and firmly attached to the tibial plateau, while the lateral one is more circular and a bit more mobile. In addition to the menisci, the knee joint also has some ligaments within the joint that help stabilize it during movement. These ligaments are the menisco-tibial ligaments, also called coronary ligaments. These help anchor the menisci to the tibial plateau. Then we've got the transverse ligament of the knee, which connects the anterior horn of both menisci and help them move in union during knee motion. On the backside, we can see this small ligament called the anterior meniscofemoral ligament, also called ligament of Humphrey. And here's its counterpart, the posterior meniscofemoral ligament, also called the ligament of Risberg. Both of these extend from the lateral meniscus to the medial femoral condyle. And here are the other joints, relative to the knee itself. Now, in addition to all of those, there are two incredibly important ligaments that form an X shape inside the joint capsule. These are the cruciate ligaments. We have the anterior cruciate ligament, ACL, and the posterior cruciate ligament, PCL. The PCL originates from the posterior intercondylar area of the tibia and ascends anteriorly to attach to the medial femoral condyle. It prevents posterior displacement of the tibia. The ACL originates from the anterior intercondylar area of the tibia and runs posteriorly to attach to the lateral femoral condyle. It prevents anterior displacement of the tibia relative to the femur. They're called cruciate because of this crossing pattern. They literally form a cross or crux. Clinically, the ACL is by far the most commonly injured ligament in the knee, especially in athletes. I will show you why a little later in this video, but now, you see all those ligaments we just talked about? These are all commonly referred to as intracapsular ligament of the knee joint, because they all lie relatively within the knee capsule. And this capsule consists of two parts. There's the synovial membrane, which lines the inner surfaces of the joint capsule and produces synovial fluid. This fluid lubricates the joint and helps reduce friction during movements. And here we can see the membrane from both an anterior and a posterior view. Lying just on top of the synovial membrane is the fibrous layer of the articular capsule, which gives the joint its outer strength and stability. And sitting on top of this fibrous capsule are ligaments that support the knee in all directions. As you see here, we've got the medial and lateral patellar retinacula. The term retinaculum refers to a fibrous band that help hold structures like tendons or the patella in place. Just above those, we can see the medial and lateral patellofemoral ligaments, which help stabilize the patella. In addition to those ligaments, we can also see this yellow structure in the center. This is called the infrapatellar fat pad, which cushions the front of the joint and fills the space beneath the patella. Sitting directly on top of the fat pad is the patellar ligament. This ligament connects the apex of the patella to the tibial tuberosity, and is essentially a continuation of the quadriceps tendon. Moving to the backside of the knee, we can see the oblique popliteal ligament and the arcuate popliteal ligament, which reinforces the posterior capsule. Now, if we rotate the joint this way, we get a view of the medial side, and rotating it this way, we can see the lateral side. On the medial side here, we can see the tibial collateral ligament, and on the lateral side, we can see the femoral collateral ligament. And you will also notice another structure here called the anterolateral ligament of the knee, and is thought to contribute to rotational stability. So those are the main ligaments of the knee. You know, the knee is so well protected. In addition to all of this, it has extra cushioning structures called bursae. Bursae are small sacs filled with synovial fluid that acts as pillows. They reduce friction and prevent tissue from rubbing against each other. There are several bursae around the knee, but some of the most important ones are the subcutaneous prepatellar bursae, deep infrapatellar bursae, subcutaneous infrapatellar bursae, anserine bursae, and the suprapatellar bursae. And if you look from the backside of the knee, we can also see the subtendinous bursae of the gastrocnemius, as well as the semimembranous bursae. So, if you now stand up and kick your leg backwards, that movement is called knee flexion. If you bring your leg forward as much as you can, that is knee extension, or even hyperextension if it goes beyond the normal range. Turn your feet outwards, that is external rotation of the knee, and inwards is internal rotation. Make sense? The knee joint is incredibly well protected, but sometimes problems still occur. Things that cause the joint to swell up, hurt, or become unstable. And now that you've seen all the internal and external structures of the knee, I want to take you through some of the most common conditions that affect this joint. So you remember the cartilage we saw earlier, right? One of the most common problems that can affect this cartilage is something called osteoarthritis. In a healthy joint, this cartilage provides a smooth, protective layer that cushions the bones and maintains proper joint space as you move. But over time, with repeated use, flexing, extending, bearing weight, that cartilage gradually starts to wear down, and this is where osteoarthritis begins. In grade 1, we start to see minor damage to the cartilage, maybe a bit of softening or roughness. By grade 2, the damage becomes more noticeable and small bone spurs may start forming around the joint edges. In grade 3, these spurs get larger and the cartilage is significantly eroded. And by grade 4, there's barely any cartilage left. The bones are now rubbing against each other, which causes pain, inflammation, and seriously limit movements. So who typically develops osteoarthritis of the knee? It's usually older adults, especially women after menopause, likely due to hormonal changes that affect cartilage repair. Obesity is a big one too, because more weight means more pressure to the joint with every step. Repeated stress on the knee from certain jobs or prior injuries and surgeries can also make the joint more vulnerable. Genetics plays a role, and muscle weakness, particularly in the quadriceps, can reduce the joint stability and increase wear over time. So how does osteoarthritis feel? People often describe the pain during activities like walking or climbing stairs, stiffness after a period of rest, usually less than 30 minutes, swelling, and you can also hear a cracking or grinding sensation called crepticus, and also reduced range of motion. As the disease gets worse, the joint might now look enlarged and deformed, and symptoms tend to flare up more in cold or damp weather. A meniscus tear is another common knee problem and can occur as a result of twisting or turning quickly. There are many different ways this can tear up. One type of tear that can happen here is called a peripheral tear, which occur along the outer edges of the meniscus. This may cause pain and swelling of the knee joint as you move. The outer zone has a good blood supply, so these kind of tears have a better chance of healing if managed properly. So who gets this injury? It happens mostly as a result of twisting injury, often with the foot planted, especially in sudden pivoting or directional changes. That's why this happens a lot in sports. We often see it in people who squat deeply, or just from general wear and tear as we get older, particularly after 40. Weak leg muscles and previous surgeries can also increase the risk. So what does the patient actually feel? Typically, localized pain on either the inner or outer side of the knee, swelling occurs a few hours later, and stiffness that limit movement, especially pain during squatting. Another common issue we have to mention is ACL tear. ACL tear is damage of the anterior cruciate ligament, which is one of the most important stabilizing structures of the knee. And when it tears, the knee becomes very unstable. The most common mechanism is when the upper leg overly rotates as the leg is fixated on the ground, or when the upper leg is pushed backwards or sideways while the lower leg is fixed. A torn ACL does not heal well on its own and usually requires surgery. So who gets ACL tear? These injuries often happen when someone suddenly stops and pivots, like in basketball or soccer. It can also occur when somebody lands wrong after a jump. The typical patient is often an athlete, and females have a higher risk, partially because of differences in anatomy and hormones. Weak hamstrings relative to the quadriceps also increases the risk. When it tears, people often describe hearing a loud pop, followed by immediate swelling and sense of instability. They can't move the knee fully anymore, and they severely lose their range of motion. Lastly, let's talk about prepatellar bursitis. Earlier, we looked at the bursae. Those are the fluid-filled sacs that cushion the joints. The prepatellar bursae sits just in front of the patella, and when it gets inflamed, the whole area swells up and becomes painful. This is sometimes called housemaid's knee. So who are most likely to get prepatellar bursitis? It often happens in people who kneel a lot, like plumbers or carpet layers, anyone putting repeated pressure on the front of the knee. But it can also be caused by a direct blow, or in some cases, an infection. Obesity and people with diabetes are more vulnerable. The symptoms are pretty easy to spot. There is swelling right over the kneecap, pain with kneeling or pressure, and in cases where it is infected, the area might feel warm, look red, and the person might even have fever. Movement becomes painful because the swelling limits how far you can bend the joint. So that was everything I wanted to go through on the knee joints. I really hope it all made sense. In the next video in the lower limb skeletal series, we are going to talk about the tibia and the fibula, how they are shaped, what joints hold them together, and what muscles attach here. Click the next video to continue learning, and I will see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.